One of my favorite one-liners from Pastor Neil is, "I will build my church." Not he, but I. Jesus says, "I will build my church." Our Lord, our Savior will build the church. And that's what we want to talk about today. And the church is more than just a building. Obviously, it is not the building, but it is people. We are the building. We're the epicenter of eternity. Right now, this place, at this time, we're the epicenter of everything. Everybody say, "I'm at the center." I'm not talking humanism now, because God is in us and He is at the core of who we are. If you're born again, He is living on the throne and He's seated on our hearts. So He's watching with expectation and joy at what we do as we rise up and walk in Him. And He sees everything we're doing. He loves what we're into in terms of His kingdom going forward. The church is not just a building. And it says, we know in Matthew 16:18, and I'll just quote it here, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail, shall not overcome, shall not rise up and conquer." Because we are the conquerors. We're the overcomers. We're great and we stand in Him. We're more than conquerors. We're greater than that. He can't conquer if we're more than that. And that's who we are. We're great. We're more than conquerors. And so when we understand this, He's building our church. Part of building the church is the assembling together of the brothers and sisters. Assembling, coming together. My brother is in the Australian SAS over in Perth, and he's spent a few years there. And when they'd blow that horn in the morning, the bugle or whatever it is, they'd all get up at the sound of the trumpet and they'd come out and march out into the middle of the quadrangle. And they'd all be lined up in their stuff and they'd be ready. Anybody ever been in the military? Hey, we should all put our hands up. We're in God's army, okay? We're here right now. And so we all line up and we're there and we're ready to go. And that's the thing. That's when we assemble together. We come together. And it's more than just assembling together. It's more than just meeting in a place where the people, the vision, the heart of God is poured in from leaders in the kingdom. Just when I just love it how Pastor Neil stands back and lets the Spirit of God come down and speak to us. Doesn't get in His road, doesn't force and push and move His own agenda. Just lets God be God. There's another one-liner. Let God be God. And I just love what God does when He builds our lives. Anybody play with Lego when you're growing up? Any Lego guys? Meccano? Anybody do Meccano, the old metal one? Okay, I remember that, Meccano. Okay. So what happened was when we were growing up, you get the Meccano set out, you know, the metal things, you got little bolts and nuts, or you get the Lego set out, the plastic ones. On the surface of the box, you've got the picture of whatever it is you're going to build and design. See, God's got a vision and a plan and a purpose for His church, His people, His family on planet Earth. It's on the front of the box. And what I used to do is I'd get the box out and I see all the pieces messed up all over the ground. I said, "Well, there's a picture." And I'd start to build and put it together. And more as it became in shape, I'd get so much more excited as I'd see the shape. And as it's done, it's got a function and a purpose. And kids love to play with toys, don't they? And you'd play. That was the function of that. Now, God's function for the church is so wonderful in the community. And that's why He's building us today. But He's building us to have expansive, large lives, to live big. And this version, there's another version of Matthew 16, and it says that I will put together my church, a church so expansive with energy that not even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. Won't be able to keep it out of anywhere. Won't be able to keep us out of the community. Won't be able to keep us out of anywhere in the community, out of government, out of schools, out of situations. The kingdoms of our God. This world will become the kingdoms of our God. And they'll rest upon His shoulders, who? The church. We're allowed to walk in Him and live in Him and move and breathe with Him around our lives. He is our God. I never dreamed I'd be doing what I'm doing in my life. I had such a poor self-esteem. We lived in this town and we were in the street I was on, had the smallest house on the street. And I was just, there were times when the bus would drive and drop us off and I'd walk so slow to get to my home because I wanted the bus to get past before I got there. And kids in our school were cruel. And the kids that weren't dressed the same, they'd get put down and they would get, you know, the kids, they don't mean to be cruel. That's just what happens sometimes. It's peer pressure. And that's what used to happen to me as a little kid. And I'd just be so, you know, ashamed at times. But then something happened. God got a hold of me and I am somebody. I am somebody that God loves and He gives life to. And He puts an answer in our hearts. And we've grown and built and matured now in Christ. And God's building a house in Canada. God's building a house in Australia. Now, we live now in an amazing place that we'd be able to pay off through miracles, debt-free. It's one of the largest houses in our province. And it's like, not to give us any glory, it's God's glory because He's done it. How could you do that? Someone, little kid in the street that's so shamed, and then all of a sudden, hey, we haven't robbed any banks, we haven't done anything wrong, it's all been good. God loves us. He's a good God. And I'm not just focusing on that. He's doing major things in our lives, and he's doing it in each one of us. One of the greatest examples of a person who's ready to live a large life was Mother Teresa. You remember Mother Teresa? You know, she's been a great example for the body of people around the world that Jesus Christ is a loving God, a generous, compassionate God. Now, people say bad things about certain things, but you can never say anything bad about the compassion that she showed over in Calcutta. And she, for 20 years, she worked as a school teacher in the walls of a convent. And she, for all that time she was in there, she spent that time, and she getting more and more agitated about being on the inside, more and more agitated about not being out there and with those billion people, little kids and hurting people and down and out. And so she just eventually got, after becoming the principal, she could have been comfortable. She could have retired as a principal. But no, she said, no, I'm getting out. She got out. And do you know the first year she was out there in Calcutta, she lived on the streets as a beggar. She had no support. She had no backing. There was no one saying, I'm behind you. So for a full year, she begged for food. She begged for a night where she could sleep and a pillow. And then she also begged for medical supplies or medicine or rags or things that she helped the poor with, help these people. So she had a heart. She displayed the love of God. And see, God wants each of us to live big lives. And by the time it was 1950, the missionaries of charity started, and its mission was to care for many people, broken, hurting people. But by 1997, it started out with 13 members, and it ended up with 4,000 sisters and hundreds of thousands of volunteers and millions of supporters around the world. Government figures and people got around. One woman, one lady. They could have retired and ended up as a principal and then going on, you know, she decided to change the lives of the world. It wasn't her. There's something inside of her. It was a compassion and a reaching heart. And I believe us as born-again believers, us as people that have the Spirit of God, us who believe the Word of God, we can have that compassion. One person can rise up and say, hey, enough is enough. And we're not all just called the broken and hurting in Calcutta, or we'd all be there. But there are people in our community, there are people out there that have these needs, but not just needs that are downtrodden. Jesus went to the Samaritan woman, yes. He went to tax collectors. He went to children. He went to Roman centurion. He also went to fishermen. Any fishermen here? I had some great fish and chips the other day with my family. Any fish? People like to go fishing? Oh, good, we got a couple. And so it wasn't just fishermen. He went to the wealthy and powerful. He went to the beggars. He went to the prostitutes. He went to the uptight religious people. I know there are no uptight religious people in this place. But I do know that Jesus is for everyone. He is for everyone, everywhere, all the time. He's for everyone, everywhere, all the time. And if you're downtrodden or you feel like you're going well in business or life or your career, but there's something on the inside that's hurt and broken and lost, God wants us to come along and work with him to help them to be fixed up and healed and delivered. Jesus had his circle. Why? Because he loved and valued humanity. The value on humanity has no limits. So whether you're a little child in Calcutta or a general of a nation or someone that's doing things great in the world, everyone has the same value. So it doesn't matter who's out there that we're spending time with or having coffee with or someone we're around. There might be situations. They might be edgy to be around. They might be hard to be around. There might be situations to be around them. But I'll tell you this, they've got value that's unlimited because God put the price of his life on every person on the planet. They haven't all received it. They haven't all found their way home yet. They haven't all come to the loving God. But I'll tell you this, God loves everyone the same. He put the price of the blood of Christ. And for that reason alone, we understand that we're called to reach to another circle and sphere of influence in our nation. And for each person here, I just see such quality. I just see such quality and richness, especially in the people that have talked to us over the last week at the conference, leaders in this house, Pastor Neil, but then there's also your team here of teachers and trainers and people that are ready. And then the people here, you could go to basically any nation and cause a revival. Why not here? There's people out there that don't know anything about God. Now, I married my wife. Before I met her, she was a heathen. So was I. And maybe you. Now, it's like that's life. But God's bringing each of us into abundant life. It says in the Message Bible in 2 Corinthians 6:11 to 13, your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. Now, what was Paul talking to the Corinthians about? He was speaking to them about their lives and certain things were small. And I'm not saying anyone's here living a small life, but I'm just saying there are areas in our lives that we can be like Mother Teresa. Anybody been a good boy or a good girl lately? Anybody? And then there are times if you've got a husband or wife, you know that husband or wife might be living a little bit different than Mother Teresa was. And I bring an illustration. The worst person I can think of was Adolf Hitler. And I don't want to say you're thinking that your husband is Adolf or you. But what I'm saying is there's a little bit of either one in each one of us. And there's something that could be around our lives where we could live small lives if we so choose to. And so if we look at Adolf Hitler's biography and you look at his life, he wanted dominion. He wanted to control. He wanted to force. He wanted to, his motive was self. As opposed to a big living life like Mother Teresa was selfless, or Jesus Christ, the ultimate selfless one, and each one of us born again believers who are full of selflessness because Christ is in there. But Hitler decided he's going to take the nations, he's going to own it for himself, he's going to be the big boss. But he ended up becoming a manipulator and a controller, and he ended up becoming someone who was a dictator. And because of that, he got a small life, and the coalition of forces at the end of his reign came and circled Berlin, and the Russian army came around, and at his small little location, fortified location in Berlin, they eventually went to a place where Hitler took his cyanide pill and blew his brains out. What an end to a person that chose a shallow life, a shallow grave, a shallow eternity, and a shallow aftermath. Everyone, now if you look at what people are doing, the body of Christ, look at Jesus, the ultimate sacrifice. 2 billion people following the teachings of Christ. I'm not saying they're all born again, but I am saying that 2 billion out of 7 billion people following the teachings of Jesus Christ, what an impact. They hit planet Earth because of that cross experience. And I just love the way Pastor Neil did communion this morning. Reality. Just so real. Not just some religious thing. It was real as a connection. And so if I can just encourage us not to, each one of us, we could look at Mother Teresa or Hitler, and there can be a small part of each in each of us, but we want the fullness of Christ shining out on this planet. And that's why each one of us, we want to encourage you to live big lives, live industriously in the Spirit. Matthew 5:16 says, keep open house. That's talking of the church, that's talking of our lives, that's talking all these different things. Keep open house, never get cloistered or small, but keep open house, be generous with your lives. Opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. And my wife's going to share some ideas on how we can stay open.
So Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Turn to the person beside you this morning and say, you are the church.
You are the church.
You are the church. He is building you because you are the church.
Yes.
And that's why Matthew said, live an open life. Live a generous life. By opening up to God, you'll prompt people around you to open up to him as well. And so we've been talking about building the church in our church this entire year. The Holy Spirit spoke to us at the beginning of the year and said, build. This is the year to build. And we've just seen God do so many great things this year in our church. We have so many people getting saved and discipled. And this morning, I want to share a little bit about that, a little bit of the process that God's been taking us through, because I believe God spoke and said, now is the time for revival. That now is the time for revival. It's not just in Canada. It's not just in Australia. It's all around the world where there are ears to hear what the Spirit is saying. God is saying, I'm going to pour out my Spirit. I'm going to build my church.
Yes.
I'm going to build my people where they will prompt the world to respond to me. They will prompt the people in their influence to respond to the living God. And so this morning, I want to be able to take you through 12 of the keys that we've learned in this last little while about preparing God's house for this coming revival. We need to prepare his house. You know, if you're inviting someone over, oftentimes you prepare your house. You get ready for the visitor. You get ready for the guests to come. We are preparing God's house for a flood of guests to come.
Yes.
We are preparing God's house for our extended family
yes.
to come home.
Find
we are
home.
Preparing God's house for this revival of people who are coming in. Number one is to serve. Psalm 84 verse 10 says, one day spent in your temple is better than 1,000 anywhere else. I'd rather be a doorman in the house of God than live in the homes of the wicked. You know, you just begin to think, where can I be a doorman? You know, that's what serving is about. Where can I be a doorman? Where can I serve? Where can I lift the load? How can I partner with God to open the house of God up to people? And as new people begin to come in, and as the younger generation begin to come in, what I've noticed is that they come in generally with a whole bag of problems. How many of you came into God's house with some problems? I can't imagine. I'm thinking about when I first came to church, that pastor must have had vision. He must have been able to see because, you know, they loved on me and spoke about my destiny. But if I was to just think back to where I was, I mean, what a scary place. I mean, I came in with a whole bag of problems.
Me too.
But there was a lot of doormen in the house of God when I came in, who encouraged me, who lifted me up, who were serving and making God's house excellent, who were doing things in God's house to make it run smoothly so that I could come and feast, so I could come and learn, so I could come and experience the presence of God. And so turn to the person beside you and say, you're a doorman. It's a great thing to be a doorman.
You're a good-looking doorman.
You're
a good-looking
looking
woman.
Doorman. Ephesians 4:11-12 says that gave some to be apostles and prophets and evangelists and shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry and for building up the body of Christ. You know, equipping the saints for the ministry. The ministry means to contribute, to serve, to attend, and to wait upon.
Yes.
You know, if you go to a restaurant, a good restaurant where they wait upon you well, you know, you come in and they make you feel at home. They take care of every need that you have. They're quick to deliver your food. Not all places, but, you know, some places are quick to deliver your food, right? And they, what are they doing? They're waiting upon you. As we prepare for these people to come, as we're preparing, as God is bringing revival to the church worldwide, we are prepared to wait on people, to serve people, that they might experience the presence of God.
Yes.
The second one, how do we prepare for this revival? Get into an encouraging spirit. And my husband already shared this morning that this is an encouraging church. So I believe you're already ahead of this, but encourage people in the house. Isaiah 35, verse 3-4 says, encourage the exhausted, strengthen the feeble, say to those with an anxious heart, take courage, fear not. Do you know, as we encourage each other, Isaiah was saying here, he was saying, you begin to speak to people who have anxiety. You begin to speak to them and say, you don't have to fear. Take courage.
Yes.
I'm beside you. We're part of the same family. We're part of the same team. We're on the same side here. And when you release encouragement, people feel free to grow and thrive. You know, where does a plant grow? A plant grows well, what, when you put it in the sunlight. You people grow where there is encouragement.
Yes.
And you know, for some people, the one encouraging word that you might give them when they come to church, that might have been the only encouragement they got all week.
True.
That might have been the only breath of life that they had on their life, of someone just encouraging them in their gift or encouraging them about who they are. Take that encouraging spirit on you. And every week when you come to church, ask God when you come, say, I'm going to your house to build the house of God with you, God. Give me a word of encouragement for someone. Be on the lookout for who you can encourage every Sunday when you come into the house. Number three is to love on people. You know, everyone needs love. And love simply means that you watch out for the welfare of others. You watch out for the welfare in others, and that is what love is. And everyone needs love. Love has no boundary of age. Love has no boundary of gender. Love has no boundary of ethnic background. Everyone needs genuine love. And 1 John chapter 4, verse 19 says, we love because he first loved us. Do you know, it's easy to not judge people when you become love. It's easy to forgive people when you become love. It's easy to not get offended at people when you become the love of God.
Yes.
But if you don't let that love of God saturate your life, we love because he first loved us. If we don't receive that love of God, then what happens is people begin to irritate us, and it's easy to hold on to unforgiveness. It's easy to get offended because somebody didn't do something the way you wanted it done. Have you noticed that not everybody's going to do something the way you want it done? I mean, if you have breath in your lungs, if you're alive, then you recognize not everybody's going to do it the way you want it done. And so love overcomes that. Ephesians 4 verse 32 says, forgive others as God has forgiven you.
Yes.
When we take on the love of God, forgiveness becomes something that becomes natural to us because we have His love. I heard a story about a man, and this man had gotten bitten by a dog. And he wasn't feeling quite right after he got bitten, and so he went to the doctor. And when he went to the doctor said, "You have rabies. Obviously, the dog who bit you had rabies, and he's bitten you, and now you have rabies." And he said, "I'm just gonna, you know, leave the room and go get a few supplies, and I'm gonna be back to take care of you." And so the doctor went out of the room, and he was gathering his supplies, and the man got out a piece of paper and a pen, and he was writing his list out. And so the doctor noticed as he was walking, he thought, "Oh, I must have not communicated well to this man." So he said to him, no, you know, "I have the antidote. I'm going to, you know, I'm going to give you a shot and you're going to be okay. I didn't mean you're going to die. I see you're writing out your will here. And, you know, I'm sorry I miscommunicated to you. You're not going to die. You're going to be okay." And the guy looked at the doctor and said, "I'm not writing out my will. I'm writing out the people I'm going to bite." And you know, sometimes that's how Christians are. We get bit, so we're looking for who we can bite. We're looking for who we can attack next. No, when we become the love of God, when the love of God comes in us, then forgiveness becomes easier. Letting go of things becomes easy. Why? Because we are loved because He first loved us.
Yes.
When this revival, as God is stirring and revival is happening and people are going to be coming from all walks of life into this church, there's going to be people who won't do things the way that you're used to. There's going to be people who won't dress the same. They won't talk the same. They won't act the same. Don't bite love. Have the love of God and chip. Yes. Everybody needs love. Yes. Love has no boundary. And thank God, when I came into the house of God, people loved me.
Yes.
I talked different. I acted different. I had a lot of hang-ups. I had a lot of baggage on my life. You know, I'd be worshiping with a passion and I'd have to run outside quick and have my cigarette and then come back in for the rest of music. You know, thank God people loved me.
Yes.
They didn't judge me. Thank God that people loved me and stood beside me and helped me walk through some of the issues in my life to bring me into freedom and to victory. I believe in this house, that's what you will be.
Yes.
You will walk with them. You will love them and walk them through to victory.
True.
Number four, how do we prepare God's house for this coming revival? We need to sow more seed. Mm-hmm. We need to ask God for supernatural ability to prosper so that we can give more, so that we can sow more. Psalm 122 verse 9 in the New King James Version says this, "Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity, Lord."
Wow.
What a great motive. Because of the house of the Lord our God, God, I will seek your prosperity. I will reach out for supernatural increase. I will reach out for creative ideas. I will reach out to prosper because my passion is the house of God. Jesus said, "I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it."
Yes.
As we build the house of God, we are going to need a lot more money. We're going to need a lot more funds. But if the motive is right, if our motive says, "God, because of your house, I will seek your prosperity. Because of your house, I will seek supernatural increase on my life so that I can sow more, so that I can give more."
Thank you, Jesus.
2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 10 to 11 says, "God is the one who supplies seed for the sower." If you want to see more money come into your life, the greatest prayer you can pray is say, "God, I am a sower. Bring me seed this week. God, I am a sower." Forget about your needs for half a second and just say, "God, I am a sower."
Yes.
And your word says that you always provide seed for the sower.
True.
Every time I prayed for seed to sow, the money has always come faster. You know, if you pray for just your needs to be met, how many know sometimes it takes a little time to get that in? But when I ask God, "God, I need seed to sow," money comes quickly to me. Mm. And then it goes on in this verse and it says, "Because then God will actually increase your seed and He will make it grow and He will produce a rich harvest from your generosity. And He will make you rich enough that you can be generous at all times, in all occasions, and many will thank God.
Wow.
I want to challenge you as we're preparing for this revival, as we're preparing for what God is doing, reach out for supernatural increase. Ask God, God, bring me seed to sow next Sunday.
Yes.
Next Sunday when I come, I want to come with a bigger seed. I want to come with a bigger offering. God, supply supernaturally so that I can be a sower.
Yes.
Number five this morning, how do you prepare God's house for this coming revival? We need to accept people. We need to accept people. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 20 to 23 says, even though I am free of the demands and expectations of everyone, I have voluntarily become a servant to any and to all in order to reach a wide range of people.
Yes.
Now, this is the range of people: religious, non-religious, meticulous, moralists, loose living, immoralists, the defeated, the demoralized, whoever. He goes on to say, I didn't take on their way of life. I kept my bearings in Christ, but I entered their world and tried to experience things from their point of view. I've become just about every sort of servant there is in attempts to lead those I meet into a God-saved life. I did it because of the message. You know, as we accept people, they're going to come. I love it. I love the way that he says, you know, the religious, the non-religious, you know, the uptight moralist, the loose living person, whatever, you know, that we just accept people.
Yes.
We don't accept the sin and think, oh, that's, you know, that I'm so happy you have that in your life. No. We accept people where they are.
Yes.
And the greatest way to do that is that we always remember where we came from. We remember where we came from. And so people in our church, I mean, they'll come and tell me crazy things. I mean, some things, and I try not to show anything on my face. I'm like, okay, yep, you know. But they'll tell me things that just shock you, of things that they've done, places they've been, things they've been involved in. You know, people will come up and they'll tell you, you know, at this time or this stage in my life, I killed somebody. You know, I should I go in now? It's been 20 years. I mean, crazy things people tell you.
True.
But if you remember where you came from, you can accept them and realize that where they came from will not be the end of their destination. That they have a purpose, that they have a call,
yes,
that God will rise them up to reach more people, and they will be evangelists. They will be people who reach people. We must accept people.
Yes.
Number six, be active in hospitality. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 9 says, show hospitality to one another without grumbling. And you know, you don't have to be perfect to be hospitable. You know, you don't have to have the perfect house. You don't have to be the best cook. You know, you don't have to be the greatest entertainer. No, you simply just have to open up your life. Open up your home and say, hey, I can have somebody over. I can eat with someone. I can have someone over and share with them. And you know, as you invite people into your home, something happens. When they're in your home, you get into their heart. And so when you begin to allow people into your home, as God is bringing people in, you have to prepare your home that I'm going to have to take somebody home on Sunday. I'm going to have to say, want to come for lunch with me? Want to come home to my home? Why? Because many people don't feel like they have a family. And so when they come here, we heard this morning that this is not a building, it's a family.
Yes.
And so when the new people come in, they're going to come in because what they are lacking, a family. And you're going to be the family. What do families do the best at? They eat together. Have you ever noticed that about families? When families get together, it always revolves around food. You know, there's always food in the middle of the family discussion. You have to open your home to them. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2 says, don't forget to show hospitality to strangers, for some have done this and entertained angels without even realizing it. And we were actually in an airport a few months ago traveling, and there was a restaurant there. We had this lovely lady who was serving us, and she was just such a great server. She was such a great waitress, and she was getting us everything. She was going beyond in every area, just serving. And I'm like, you know, you're probably one of the best, you know, servers that we have ever had. You're so gifted and good. And she said, well, you know, you could be an angel. I could be entertaining an angel. And I said, honey, I don't want to bust your bubble, but I know I am no angel. You know, I've been called the other side a few times, you know, but I am no angel. But, you know, if we take on the heart, what about that heart? She said, you could be an angel. I'm like, I'm not, right? But she said, you could be.
Yes.
What if we served and were hospitable to people in the same degree that I'm serving God? You could be an angel. You could be royalty. You could be, you know, the top of the top. You could be. If we serve, she served us like we were the greatest people she'd ever met.
Yes.
As the house of God, if we take that on and get prepared, as new people come in this door, we're prepared to serve them, to invite them home, to include them in our family, to open up our arms, to open up our life, to include them in an extended family. You will see people be planted in the house of God and flourish in a great way. Number 7, your uniqueness brings out God's flavors. You being you, your uniqueness, the way you are, that is part of this coming revival. Your gift, your talent, the way that you're different. You know how some of you have that kind of quirky personality or quirky sense of humor? You know, come on, point at somebody and say, that's you. You know, you're a little different. You're unique. Do you know God made each person the way they are to reach people? He knows who'll need that personality. He knows who'll need that sense of humor. He knows who's going to need that particular style of person. And so he's placed you here with different gifts, different talents, different personalities for a purpose, because he knows who's coming in. He knows who he's bringing in. And each one of you is valuable and is needed. And the scripture says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, it says, we are here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with it. Your gift, your talent, wherever you serve in the house, is bringing out the God colors to people as they come in. Number 8, show enthusiasm for God. Show enthusiasm for God as you come here. Romans 12:11 says, serve the Lord enthusiastically. And this was the number one thing that influenced my life for Christ the most when I came into the church. So I came into the church and I met some radical people. I met some on fire believers, and they were so enthusiastic. They would be like, you know, we just can't wait for the service to start. We're just so excited. You know, I mean, we only got 5 more minutes and the service is going to start. I was like, these people are crazy, right? You know, and they were so enthusiastic. We can't wait till midweek. We can't wait till Bible study. It's going to be so awesome. You got to be there. And they were talking about, I remember this one lady, she had her check and she's like, I can't wait. I am so excited to give my tithe and my offering. And she had this check. And I remember I was a new Christian. I was kind of looking at how much it was, you know, but she was so enthusiastic. She could barely wait for the offering plate because she was so excited to give that day. When the music started, they were jumping in on the first song. It didn't take them 3 songs to get in because they had such incredible enthusiasm. And I remember thinking, these people are crazy. But you know what? I joined them. Because there was something that was contagious about their enthusiasm. There was something about the way that they spoke about the house of God. Yeah. There was something about the way they spoke about reading their Bible every morning. Yes. There was something about the way that they spoke about hearing God's voice personally to them. There was something the way they spoke about giving. Something the way that they spoke about serving in the house of God. I remember this one person, and they were so excited. They said, I'm just so excited. Today, I get to sweep up after church. I thought, you are the craziest people I've ever met. Who gets excited about sweeping? Anybody get excited about sweeping? You know, I wouldn't call sweeping my favorite job, but there is enthusiasm about every area. Do you know that enthusiasm? When I came into the church, I was saved, but that's what planted me. That's what grew me. That's what changed me. That's what gave me a passion, because it was contagious. It was coming on me from all sides. Pretty soon, I was just as crazy as them. I was talking just like them. And thank God I was. I always say, God, I thank you. That was the first church I ever went to. Yes. Thank you, Jesus, I didn't go to a dead church first. Thank you, Jesus, that I didn't go to a bunch of grumblers and whiners who were were sitting on their backside not doing anything. God, I thank you that my first church was an enthusiastic church that changed and transformed my life so that I would serve God with a passion. When you carry enthusiasm, when the people come in, when new people are coming in, it will be contagious on their life. Share your enthusiasm. Number 9, help others be planted. You know, you're planted. And because you're planted in this house, you can help someone else put down their roots. You can help them place their roots down in the deep soil. Yes. Psalm 92, verse 13 to 14 says, planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish. Verse 14 in the Amplified Bible goes on to say, and they will grow in grace, and they will be rich in trust and love and contentment.
Yes.
Because you're planted, you have the ability to help someone else's roots go down deep. Do you know, your roots have to go down deep if you really want to get big and strong. When the roots are on the just on the edge, that plant is always struggling. But when your roots are down deep, there is something that enables that plant to grow strong and grow bigger and grow stronger and then grow bigger and then grow stronger and then grow bigger and then grow stronger and then grow bigger. And that's what's happening here. God sets the foundation so that when people come in, you will help them be planted. Just a couple more. Number 10, how do we prepare for this coming revival? We just need to reach one more person.
Yes.
Just reach one more. A lot of times we think, I have to reach 100, I have to reach 1,000, I need to reach a million. You know, if we just focus on reaching one, if we just focus on, in this next month, I'm going to reach one person and bring that one person to church. I'm just going to begin to believe God for that one person.
Yes.
I'm going to begin to pray for that one person. I'm going to begin to, you know, see a picture of that person serving Jesus, coming to church with me. We simply just need to reach one person. Romans chapter 12, verse 11 to 13 says, don't burn out. Keep yourself fueled and aflame. Be alert servants of the master, cheerfully expectant. Don't quit in hard times, but pray all the harder. Help other people. You know, if we simply have a heart for one more. Do you have one person in your life right now who doesn't regularly attend church, but you can begin to believe for them?
Yes.
You can begin to reach out to them. You can begin to pray for them. You can begin to ring them. You can begin to love on them. You can make sure that you're the one who remembers their birthday. You can simply reach out to one. God will give you that one. I was somebody's one. He was somebody's one.
True.
That they believed and stood with us until we came through on the other side. I believe each one of you needs to make a chair beside you. Don't do it right now. But, you know, you know, in the spirit, make that chair and say, I recognize this chair this person will be sitting in. Begin to see them coming with you and reach that person. Number 11, decide to be a laborer in this revival. Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 38, we know the scripture, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Just decide that you're going to be a laborer in whatever capacity you can be. God, whatever you need me to do, I'm going to labor. Whatever you need me to do, I'm going to serve. God, whatever you need to do, I recognize that people are coming. God, if there's a job description for me, God, I'm going to get into the job description. I am a laborer in the harvest. You know, there's no greater time to be alive than right now.
True.
Nobody has seen what we are about to see.
True.
If we were to rewind and go back in history, people would love to be alive in our day and
yes.
age. Because this is the greatest
yes.
time to be alive to say,
thank you,
I
Jesus.
Am a laborer in
thank
the harvest.
You, Lord.
I am a laborer in this harvest time. And the last one this morning, how do we prepare for this coming revival? Is to walk and live in the Spirit.
Oh,
Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, that's what it says. Walk and live habitually in the Spirit. If you read the Amplified Version, it says this. But I say walk and live habitually in the Holy Spirit, responsive to and controlled by and guided by the Spirit. Then you will certainly not gratify the desires of your human nature, but you will gratify that of God.
Yes.
You know, as we choose to just live and walk in the Spirit of God. You know, walking with God's an adventure. It's no longer a boring life when you're walking in the Spirit. I mean, you don't know who you're going to meet, what divine appointment God's going to place in your life. You know, I mean, there's so much excitement, so much adventure to saying, God, I want to hear from you. I want to stay in step. Yes. This verse says, living habitually. Let it be your habit to be in the Spirit.
I just love this. And that started where I started out today, and I started talking about living expansive lives. I'd like to read that verse again, and we'd just like to see what's happening next. See, Matthew 16, verses 17 and 18. Jesus came back. God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. And then it says towards the end, I will put together my church, a church so expansive with energy, then not even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. Got a question today. Where has the enemy tried to keep you out of? I'm not saying that we force in with our own motives or our own ways or our own desires, but God, when we're walking in the Spirit, God does something amazing. Our lives lived expansively. It's an experience every single day. It's an adventure. Just close your eyes for a moment today. You haven't had that opportunity to step into that adventure of a lifetime. I remember many years ago when I was growing up and at school, and I had friends, but I didn't ever think that I'd end up married to such a beautiful girl, having just awesome children, living in Canada was a country that I would have most loved to have lived in growing up. And I got to live there. I'm living my dream. Things are just going so wonderful. And see, God loves you. He cares about you. He's got the best in store for you. It is in store. But we got to open up that can. You get the can open and crack it out and open it up and enjoy the life that He has for you. If it's been like your life's been in a can, you've been crushed, you've been broken, you've been held back, and you've been stopped from just having that experience of wonderful living, I'd just like to invite you today to receive Jesus, to know that He can open the lid and give you an amazing adventure where there are no limits. That's you here today, and you just say, yes, Jesus, I'd like to know. You just slip up your hand and say, that's me. I felt contained. I felt there's been things around my life where I've been restrained from receiving good. Maybe even people around me have said some things that were hurtful or wrong and brought pain into my heart, and I don't want that stuff. That's not what I want. I'd like to be around people that encourage me and love on me and just care about me. They don't judge me. They don't put me down. If you're here today, you're saying, hey, that's me. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to look at you, put our things. Anybody, slip up your hand. Okay. If you're here today and you're saying, hey, listen, God, I want more. There's more for me. There's more for me to live in and walk in and join in your body. When I hear that trumpet blow, when I hear that sound from heaven, I just want to be one of those ones that come out and join, to be a part of that team, to be a part of that rising army and saying, Lord, I will go with you. I will walk with you. If that's you here today, just slip up your hand and say, that's me. I want to be a part of the team. I want to be a part of the army. Slip your hand up and say, yeah, that's me. Just say, that's me. That's me, that's it. Just slip it up and say, me. No, it's not to me. Talk to God. Say, it's all you, Lord. It's all you, Lord. It's all you. It's you, it's you, it's you. Just say this. Say, my life is in your hands. Have your way. Lead me. And guide me where you want me to go. And I will follow. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Pastor Neil. God bless you.
Hey,
too.
Let's give them all both a big clap. Amen. 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 Amen.